worth of exploitation. Chrome, 9.8 million tons. Nickel, 4.5 million tons. Coal, 26 million tons. Diamond, 16.5 million tons. Iron ore, and these are another, the world sold after the commodity iron ore, 30 million tons. Copper, 5.2 million tons. Copper, methane, is the largest non-reserve market. So it is the resource-rich economy, and the beauty of Zimbabwe is that it is diversified. You're not just looking at manufacturing or financial services, you also have the tourism. Tourism is another huge sector. You know, next year, Zimbabwe will be hosting the United Nations World Tourism Organization General Assembly in Victoria Falls in August next year. So all roads are leading to Victoria Falls. So there are opportunities to invest in hotels, conference facilities, and so on. Health facilities at the venue, the conference, all those kinds of opportunities. Those interested in agro processing, kind of opportunities in the value chain, and so on. And our Zimbabwe Stock Exchange is one of the oldest stock exchanges in the world. And it has been working very closely with the London Stock Exchange for many, many years. Our capitalization at the stock, at our stock market, is around $4 billion. And we are affected by hyperinflation during our troublesome years. And now we are rebuilding our stock market, so the capitalization is about $4 billion. Very good performing companies. There are some companies that are dual listed, that are listed on the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange, London Stock Exchange, and the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. The number we all Mutizwa, the South Africa, so we put a robust trading system, and shares are changing hands. So if you don't want to invest in the these other sectors, you just actually buy stocks or shares on the stock market with competent asset managers, fund managers, who can really show you the way in investing on the stock market. One other advantage for Zimbabwe is that we've got price stability now. Because when you're an investor, you have to look at your rate of return. So you have to invest in a low inflation economy. And our inflation is 3.5%. I think we use the lowest in Africa. 3.5%. So your return will also be guaranteed. But one of the things that we've always touted about Zimbabwe is that, unlike in most African countries, Zimbabwe is with highly educated people. So it's easy to do business because the people are highly qualified, highly educated. And they're very proficient in the English language. They can read and write. They're very well. So it's one of the, if you go to Mozambique or Angola with due respect, you have to navigate the language barrier, transactional problem. Nice English speaking countries like Zimbabwe is something that you cannot avoid. So I have said we have a diversified economy, and we are growing economy, which is good for you as investors, and we have good infrastructure. Our roads, our systems are fairly robust by African standards. You can actually come to Harare, and in one of the streets you can think you are in London. So our infrastructure is reasonable. But what you must bear in mind
is that when you are investing in Africa, you must also have tolerance for risk. Have also some tolerance for risk. And you should also have the pioneering mentality. As we are sitting here on this table, the Chinese are on the ground, investing, doing business, and so on. Let's have a pioneering mentality. Let's not do an overkill on due diligence. That's my message. Let's have a pioneering mentality. And always have a deep knowledge of the countries that you are investing in. And I think this kind of forum will equip you with better knowledge on the destination that you intend to invest. And always be aware of the regulatory environment or the legal regulatory environment, which is what I want now to talk about. When investors talk about investing in Zimbabwe, I always think of indigenization. Are our assets going to be safe? Our investment going to be safe? This law was passed in 2007 by Parliament. And all it says is that Zimbabwe shall aspire to have 51% equity being locally owned. So it's an aspire, it's aspirational. It's an aspirational law. It's not saying, give me, just say we aspire. We may not get there, but it is just an aspiration. The situation on the ground is that no company has been seized in Zimbabwe, or nationalized, or expropriated. No command that has been expropriated over time. And what's happening now is that government has agreed to say no, let's be flexible with this policy. Let's engage investors, let's get their concerns, let's get their worries. And in some cases, investors are being exempted from compliance, 100%. I've just given you the example of our airline, where government says we won't maintain 26%, to show you how flexible the legislation is. Because there's no way we can take 51%, because the investor will lose management control, and we don't want that. That affects confidence. So we've realized that, that's why we've become so flexible, and we are also allowing what we call credit, international credit. Depending on the level of your corporate social responsibility, depending on your level of skills transfer and technology transfer, and depending on your level of engaging in local value chain in terms of procurement. So we assess to what extent you are localized and consider that as sufficient. So the 51% is no longer, you know, written or cast in stone. We consider all those credits, empowerment credits, employee ownership schemes, and all that. So this is why, but you cannot know this unless you get the information and actually test the market yourself. So I can say that yes, indigenization is still on our statute books, but if I were an investor, I will not be deterred because it's aspirational. All countries, Zimbabwe is not the first country to have indigenization, but all countries have got empowerment law. South Africa, Malaysia, you know, all those countries have got empowerment law. But we have said, let us be flexible, let us be pragmatic. There are certain areas where we need high tech capital, and we exempt or give more a longer period for compliance. So I just want to stress that indigenization is not nationalization, it's not expropriation. But the most important thing is that the 51%, if ever one is going to get there, you have to put money on the table, you have to follow your rights. You can't just say I want it 1% by word of mouth. Yes. Follow your eyes, put money on the table. So it won't happen. It is just a fear of the unknown. The other thing is the sovereign risk or the political risk. You are aware that Zimbabwe is going through a transition period. We are in an inclusive government or a coalition government. In Britain, you already have the experience of a coalition government. And the one thing about coalition government is that from time to time you can get contradiction of policies or messages because it's a coalition. So we try from time to time to be consistent and avoid the ambiguities in pronouncements and so on. But I must say that the inclusive government or coalition government is given the economy the room to breathe and is enabled to create an enabling environment for investment. Going forward, politically, we've just done our constitution. The constitution will go for a referendum. And next year there will be general elections, which we want to be free and fair. And we'd like those elections to be supervised by the United Nations, AU, the European Union, and other levels. So we are moving forward as a country. We have made our mistakes in the past, but we are moving forward as one country. There's anything that we are all agreed across the political divide is that let's protect investors, let's create a good investment climate for investors. This is the reason why in 2010 the government of Zimbabwe to put up a one-stop shop investment center. Now we've got a one-stop shop investment window in Harare, where if you're an investor, you come from the airport, you go straight to the investment center. You present your investment proposal. Within 5-14 days, we can give you an investment license. Those are major reforms. Previously, we would spend not less than 90 days to issue out a license. Now, we can issue a license within 5-14 days with a one-stop shop. So in that one-stop shop, we've got so many government departments under one roof. We've got the company registration department, we've got the Department of Taxes, we've got the immigration, we've got the environmental people there, we've got the mining there, and all those key departments that have something to do with the issue of expense or like under one roof. And we've got feedback from investors. But it's one thing that they admire about Zimbabwe, the investment reform, the liberalization that we are implementing on investment, promote investment. Because the world bank does what we call doing business service. So we try to respond to those world bank doing business reports by improving our doing business environment. So we put in a one-stop shop at the Zimbabwe Investment Authority office, where investors can be rest assured that their investments are processed and processed fairly quickly without any problems. But the law requires a company investing in Zimbabwe to be domiciled locally, so you need to register your company locally and comply with all the tax provisions before you can start operating. And this is not unique to Zimbabwe. It's happening in all other countries. So when you think of Zimbabwe, think of a country which has good institutions, which has good systems. As I'm talking to you right now, we we are in charge of spearheading investment promotion. We've got a bill which we call the investment Zimbabwe Investment Authority Amendment Bill. This bill is going to amend the law so that we can exempt new investors from the provisions of the regulation. And this bill has got clauses to protect investors. So those are some of the reforms that we have. We also have what we call an investors roundtable, where from time to time, government will sit down, just like we are doing here, key investors to say what are the problems. Where do you want us to reform? How can we protect you? What are the challenges? So we've got an investors roundtable where investors can meet government directly and communicate their concerns in terms of the investment climate, the legislation, whatever they want to point out. The idea is that we must be able to look at Zimbabwe as a brand. But if an investor comes to invest, they know that they're investing in a brand. But I must say that even with all these regulatory changes, there's no safe haven on earth. There's nothing which is totally called a safe haven on earth. There are always problems. Even on which jurisdiction you go, you always have unique challenges in a particular country. But what we need to do is to continually improve the investment climate so that doing business becomes very similar. One of the things that we are doing is to